it's amazing that you could encapsulate in such a short time and cover all the facets of the DP, all the challenges and all the innovative solutions that have come through. I'm sure you have a lot of questions. Please raise your hand well in advance. Our volunteers will come and give you the mics. Please be careful when you pass the mics because these are not cordless mics. And keep your questions very precise. Do remember what Mr. Jha said about the process of planning and the process of implementation being different. So keep your questions very relevant, keep them crisp, and avoid leading questions as far as possible.
It is about the institutional efficiency. Any plan is as good as its execution. So we have seen how the civic agency is always beset with inefficiencies, so to speak, especially when it comes to developers and people who get involved in urban construction activities. So does the DP plan also have some mechanism to ensure that the execution of the plan is unhindered by bureaucratic inefficiencies?
DP, if you look at DP talking about inefficiencies, I think the very first question is about execution. And DP is about spatial plan. We have tried to deal with it a bit in terms of DP implementation process. That's why we are working on DP implementation. I think one of the major problems with the implementation of DP has been the fact that when you formulate your annual budget, and I have told this in many lectures, then the municipal administration does not keep the DP in front of it. You formulate a budget, but when you are formulating a budget, part of the challenge of formulating the budget is that DP needs to be given a priority because the quality of life in the city will fall out of the DP. And therefore, my suggestion has been that when you formulate your annual budgets, the implementation plan will tell you that this is what my annual performance ought to be in the DP, because the DP has to be broken up in 20 parts and each part needs to be provided for every year. So if you then keep the DP in front of you and provide for whatever is going to be done in regards to the DP in that annual plan, that would be the starting point of the implementation of DP. This has not happened. I remember my own days when I was municipal commissioner. No one came before me and told me, until in the third year I realized that I have totally failed in looking at the DP while doing my budget. The budgetary exercise cannot be bereft of a very serious look at the implementation of the DP.
Yeah, just a very quick request. This is time for the students to ask questions, so all other stakeholders can ask their questions after the event has been concluded.
Hello, sir. My name is Nidhi and I'm from Lokmanathilam. My question is just basically from a conservationist point of view. You've talked about reducing green spaces along our coastal line, and
I can hear.
Yeah.
I'm just asking about the preservation of the heritage of
the Kolivadas and the Gautams. We have about 88 of those. So won't that get hampered?
You see, the Kolivadas, the Adivasi Padas, and some of these old hamlets that are part of Mumbai, they are being looked at by different organizations of the government. For instance, the Adivasi Padas are being enumerated by the Tribal Welfare Department. What we have said in the DP is that whatever would be the instructions of these departments in terms of what to mark, that has been that will be marked on the DP. Again, it's a flexible, the flexibility part of the DP which will take care of that. There are two schools of thought, on Kolivadas and Adivasi Padas. What should be the way they are maintained? Should they remain the way they are, or should they undergo a change as other areas have changed? We have not answered this question in full because we feel that the Kolivadas should be left untouched. And therefore, the kind of development has been provided, which has been provided in Kolivadas, is extremely marginal. But the first task that departments will have to perform is to find out which are these Adivasi Padas and Koli Wadas. Especially in the case of Adivasi Padas, it is extremely difficult because some of these Padas have five families, four families. They are strewn all across, and enumerating them is a huge task. But there has to be a balance in the kind of view that you take about Koli Wadas and Adivasi Padas. But this was something which we had to address, and we have tried to address it as far as we could in the DP.
Hello sir, I'm Sukrat Singh from Sir JJ College of Architecture, and currently we're doing an exercise on the design exercise on the Eastern Harbour front, the waterfront, and we were doing a bit of research on that, and we realized that there are a lot of leasing issues with the land owned along that front, and there have been difficulties in garnering that land because most of the leases are no more, they have expired, or they have been given to other leasers which are not authorized. So is the DP dealing with that in any way, or how is that acquisition happening on the waterfront?
I think again it is a question beyond the DP to answer, because the mechanism of how they would be acquired, unless they are totally private lands, if the lease is expired, then what do you do with that lease? Who gave the lease? In details, these would have to be studied individually, and a plan would have to be prepared on how to go about it. But if the DP says that this is the use that should be made of this land, then the process starts of achieving that use over a period of time by eliminating all the obstacles that stand in the way of that use. But the DP is not equipped to go into how that will be done. That's a totally executive decision that will have to be taken outside the DP.
Hello. Sir.
Yeah.
My name is Abhishek. My question is, as per the 1991 DP, there was about 13,000 hectares of land for non-development zone, which has now been dropped down to 3,000, and the 10,000 has been given to national areas. So,
natural areas.
And out of those 3,000 hectares of NDZ also is going to be used up a little bit for the construction, right?
Not little bit,
most of it, okay. So now does that mean the 10,000 hectares which has gone to natural area, can that also be used for construction in the leisure? Because since we opened RA recently for the construction.
No, RA has not been opened for construction. I think that's a misnomer. The construction that was, firstly let me answer your NA question. Now, once you put the area into natural area, then what you have said is that there is no buildable development possible there. So if there is a mangrove, you could probably have a nature trail so that people can go and enjoy that mangrove. But if you were to put up a structure on it, no, you can't. And as soon as it becomes natural area, then any construction, even if perforce someone, you know, thinks about it later, which is not to be thought, but suppose you have this perception that it could be misused, then the natural area, being in an eco-sensitive zone, comes under the Environmental Ministry's purview, and therefore you will have to get an environmental clearance to step into it. And that's the reason why it has been put into natural area, because once put into natural area, I think it is well nigh impossible to get into that, unless there is a plausible reason. Like a technical mistake has been made that there is a certain plot of land which has been put into natural area but which is already built. Such errors could happen. But otherwise it's inviolate, nothing can be built on it. And the rest of it is, you know, on the NDA, on DZ land. As I told you, the NDZ zone in 91 was a hold all kind of a zone where natural areas, buildable areas were all put. There are certain areas that are already built. There are slums on, you know, NDZ land, there are roads, there are constructions. So it's not that all of NDZ, erstwhile NDZ, was totally undevelopable. And therefore we have carved out that area which is developable. And the theory is that any developable land which is left in Mumbai must go to bridge the deficits which the city has, and for nothing else.
Hello sir, I am Nikhila Jadhav from Rachna. Sir, my question was in continuation with the NDZ. For residential, we are just proposing affordable housing. So won't this, that means only low income group people will be shifted there. So won't this segregate these people from the city?
That's a good question. 30, 45 and 660 that has been provided, but the NDZ land per se you would have seen is only 750 hectares for affordable housing. That will not be able to take this entire 1 million population. In any case, what we have provided there is going to have a population of around, I think, 15 to 20 lakhs. Now, whether the population goes there or not is something that will have to be seen. But if you have no other land, then it doesn't make sense to, you know, provide things that are other than deficits in the city to be provided there. And therefore, we do feel that over a period of time, an entire new township of the kind that you want could go. And I will explain this. If I have 750 hectares of affordable housing, there is another piece of 34% of land which goes to the developer, right? The owner of that land. Now, the owner of the land obviously is not going to duplicate it and build affordable housing there. They will build a different kind of housing which will be sold in the open market. Once that kind of housing is created, along with public amenities, institutional areas, and commercial setups, then it's a natural place where employment will grow. This will not happen in 1 year. And if employment grows, then the affordable housing component kicks off. For the simple reason that there will be that kind of job opportunity created there. So I think we have to look futuristically on what are the possibilities of that land.
One more question is there. It is regarding to your heritage structures. So as you are the chairman of heritage committee also, so now when we see some buildings in fort are in very bad conditions. So are there any provision in this DCR for redevelopment or something? Because sir, now when we see like Amdan Divas, so we are retaining the exterior facade, but we are doing something interiorly. But there will be a period when all this building will slowly or gradually will be tearing. So on this land, maybe the whole fort will become a ghost land because of all this building getting deteriorated. So is there any provision for future development of this?
I think you've hit an area where I missed out. I missed out not in the DP, but in talking about it here. The heritage sites under the DCR have been equated with accommodation reservation policy. So again, if the owner wants, it's not that he will have a 60-40 division, because the land cannot be, you know, used for anything other than as a heritage building. So the heritage building has to stand. But the benefits that will accrue to him if he maintains this property is the same as an accommodation reservation policy would give. This is a new interpolation in the DCRs to promote heritage. That is one. Number two is, there could be properties of heritage where the owners would not be able to take care of their properties. So we have listed three commercial areas and we have called them heritage areas, heritage markets. Meaning thereby that whatever development takes place on those lands, that is generated out of that development would be separately marked out in a heritage fund which will go for the maintenance of these buildings. So these twin provisions have been made in the DCRs for heritage buildings. It's a good question, and it was something which I had to address. Being the chairman of the heritage committee, it was doubly important for me to having to do something, and I think this was a an area which was long missing and which needed to be plugged. My only worry is that we need to have a debate on how many structures we should put into heritage. You know, because once you put structures into heritage, without your ability to actually help the owner to maintain them, then you are making private property public, because it gets publicly colored, it becomes public building, the person cannot do with anything with it. So my view has been, personal view, I don't think other, I've shared this, but I'm sharing it for the first time, that if there is a particular kind of, say, architecture that has to be protected, how many examples of that architecture should you protect? It cannot be that you protect all of them, right? Because you want to remember the past, that this was something created in the past. So the best specimens of those architecture need to be protected. But if we are going to multiply them in huge numbers, it becomes impossible for the municipal corporation then later to look after. So there needs to be a debate and a discussion on what should go into heritage.
Hello, sir. Sarang here from Bharati Vidyapeetha, College of Architecture. The question is, executing a DP or the proposed things is one thing, but the maintenance of the executed things is another thing. So are there any rules and regulations from DC 2034 and DCR on competent authorities like MCGM and all these, or for in regarding the maintenance of whatever you execute in the DP?
I think again you need to go back to what I said in the beginning. DP is a spatial enabler. It's not an executive arm which can tell you what to do and what not to do. Maintenance is extremely important, you are right, because it happens that amenities that are created are not maintained properly. And a term taking from the medical sciences that I have coined is that these amenities go what is called an atrophy. So amenity atrophy need not happen in cities. Municipal corporation has to provide adequate funds either to maintain them itself, or it has to find a mechanism to do it. And I think land instruments are the best instruments through which you can find that mechanism. Budget will always have a constraint, but land instruments can be properly used for that.
Yeah, three more questions on this side, and then maybe a couple on that side, and then we can close it to the next.
Let them ask you.
Please go ahead.
I don't get an opportunity to interact.
Hello, sir. My name is Varad Sathe. I am from Lokmanya Tilak College of Architecture. And I have a question regarding the housing units that are to be created. How will be the power, water, road and drainage infrastructure for the excess of housing to be created?
Roads are marked, right? And my engineer, Mr. Singh Sachdev, he would tell you that once you have marked roads, then all services flow along those roads. So you will have a road, you will have a water line, you will have sewer, you will have other things. Is it an extra load on the city? That's what your question is. It's a relocation of people. Population is 12.79 million. So this affordable housing component is essentially targeting people who are within the city, because the norms that would be laid for who will get this affordable housing. These affordable housing units are not going to be available to anyone. He must be able to perform role. He has been performing a role in the economy of Mumbai, and he must satisfy certain criteria on the basis of which he will get this. So it becomes a reallocation of population. So it's not an additional load that will actually happen, but that certain populations, for instance, who are living in slums, who do not qualify to be in slums. You know, when slum redevelopment takes place, a 25% section will not be eligible for slum redevelopment. But if he sees that he qualifies for this and he can get house as cheap as 6 to 7 lakhs, then he would be enthused to come here and live in a proper environment rather than to remain there. So it would be mostly a reallocation, and therefore it would not be an additional pressure in terms of more water, more sewage, etc. Of course, the lines have to be laid. And the lines, that has been figured out. And that would be something which the municipal corporation's budget would be able to take care of.
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. My name is Ankita, and I'm from Kamala Dalija College of Architecture. And my question is about Kharodi village, which is near, which is in Malvani, Malad. And it was denoted as an existing slum in the DP. So it was not a slum, it was a very built structure all over in that area. So why that locality is denoted as an existing slum is my question.
You'll have to ask the SRA about that. As I told you in the very beginning, the question of enumerating slums has been handed over to the SRA. So we have not gone into that question, but what troubles you in that?
Because the locality is not aware about it, and they are giving their they are approaching to the development plan authority about it. We are working on development plan right now, and we are coming.
What do they want?
They want that it was not denoted as the existing slum in the DP plan.
No, as I told you, if that is the question, then the SRA is doing the listing of slums, and I'm sure the SRA will do justice to that. So if it gets notified as a slum, then it would be liable to slum redevelopment if the owners are, if the residents are agreeable to that. Okay?
Residents are not agreeable to it.
What do they want then?
They don't want to be a part of the slum. It's they, not a, they want that part as a residential patch.
I think if they approach the SRA, I don't think the SRA would be too eager to have them under slums, because you can't force people to come under slums. If someone doesn't want to be notified as a slum, it's a good thing. It can develop independently as a housing society. I think the SRA should be able to accept that.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I'm Sanjana from Tata Institute. And the question I want to ask is, like, now the DP will go through a period of suggestion and objection, and the DP team hasn't, it can either accept them or it can reject them. So in if there are, how flexible is your plan to open to such, if there are suggestions and objections, would you be flexible enough then? For example, if people are against Central Park in the south of the tip of the city, would you be open to changing your plan and making such changes? Many other.
Yeah, I think it's a good question that will add to the understanding of what happens after the draft DP is published. After the draft DP is published, there is a statutory committee which is appointed. And the statutory committee has 3 members from the municipal corporation, 4 members from the government. We lose the right to interfere with the recommendations of the statutory committee. The statutory committee will make the recommendations, the corporation is going to go through the DP, and then the government will take a final decision. As far as the administrative wing of the municipal corporation is concerned, our role is over. So my being open or not open will not arise, unless the committee wants an opinion from us, which I think the committee would be equipped to take a decision themselves.
Sir, I have a question. I am Jaydeep from Kamala Haiga School of Architecture. I would like to ask, what sort of ideals or lifestyles do you envision or refer to when laying down a DP?
What kind of?
Ideals or lifestyle do you refer or envision to while laying down a DP for a city?
I think if you open the DP, then there is a chapter on objectives, goals and targets, and it lists out spatially what is it possible to be done. And some of the things we talked about are about lifestyle, but a detailed kind of a lifestyle analysis in the DP is not possible. I don't think it should even be done, because then the state becomes intrusive. You are determining for the people what lifestyle they should lead. Why should the state come into that? That's an individual decision.
Hello, sir.
Sorry.
I'm the big airport at Santa Cruz. Because of that, because of the height restrictions, a lot of buildings in the suburbs are not getting redeveloped. So it is obviously the center's, rules and regulations. But are there any revisions in the height restrictions because of the airport?
This question was addressed by my DCR team. Now, as far as the municipal corporation is concerned, it is not possible for us to not accept the airport authority's height restrictions. However, what we have provided is that we have allowed a larger use of land underground, because height is restricted, but going underground has not. So there is a provision that you can do more things under the ground in the basement than what you were allowed to do earlier. So that's the provision that has been made.
No changes.
The airport's authority, whatever they say, that is the height.
So,
and that's why right in the context I told you that there are so many other bodies that have their own stipulations. And the municipal corporation, a city, you know, the city government, in the hierarchy of these, it is the third tier. And therefore, many other things have to be accepted because they have been provided for their own valid reasons. Yes,
sir. I'm Bhupa D'Souza from Bharati Vidya Peeth, pursuing urban planning. Right now, happiness index of Mumbai compared to other global cities is very low. So the main aim of DP should be to make citizens happy. After implementation of your DP, what would the happiness index of Mumbai be, or what is the target?
Happiness. it's a valid question. This is the first time I'm hearing that the DP needs to also calibrate happiness. it's beyond the special provisions that the DP deals with. But the question is important because ultimately it is happiness which determines how good a city is or how bad a city is. But I'm a little doubtful that the rest of the world is happier than Indians. Indians, I don't think anyone celebrates as many festivals. Every day we have a festival, almost. Every day we have mirth and laughter around, although we have tears as well. So I think the cultural mooring of the country is so strong that happiness is not something alien to Indians. But I'm sure if you were to calculate and calibrate happiness as it exists today, it would definitely improve after this DP is implemented. And it would be a task that you could take up as a planner. But what will happen after 20 years, I think it's too long a period to predict today.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Jay.
But thanks for imparting some humor to the discussions here. Again, planning subject is a dry subject. So it's good. Yes?
Well, I had to ask you about the Eastern Waterfront. When we visited the place, we saw that it wasn't open to public. So do you think it has potential to be used as a public space? Or do you think it is a better proposal to have a very tall tower, as Nitin Gadkari has talked about before?
There are public places also planned along that. It's not that the towers will be there and there will be no public places of enjoyment. So I think that you need to study that plan properly. I think they have a combination of both. As every time you look at a question, as a planner, I'm talking as a planning student, you have to look at all the three aspects of what a city has. You cannot say that every part of land in a city has to have a specific direction and nothing else. It's never like that. So if there is public open space, which means that you are adding to the environmental quota and quotient of the city, you also need to add to the economic quotient, right? And the economic quotient needs to look attractive because that is what is going to bring people in and get you money in the city. And the GDP will be driven by activities that will generate jobs and employment and visitors from abroad. So that is an important part. It has to. What happens is that if you completely imbalance it, and it has happened in global cities, because of globalization, what has happened, what we call as the commodification of land, when more and more land is attributed to economic use, then the other uses get sidelined, and that imbalances the city. The idea is to balance it. Singapore has done part of that. It has great places, great towers, great commercial areas, but they are combined with attractive looking open spaces all along. So I think if you have a front as beautiful as what Mumbai has, we need to go in for a combination of these things and balance the two so that the best results are achieved both economically and environmentally.
So that basically means that there's a potential for both the things happening together.
Why not?
It's a better thing to have both of them together.
It's not a question of both things. Some places both things may not happen or are not required. For instance, in a CBD there can be more construction, but the idea of having higher FSI is that you get to a narrower piece of land and go up. So you marry vertical space but leave the rest of the space beautified, which is open. In generally everywhere this combination should be able to work, except in some exceptional cases.
So regarding the implementation of the development plan, as you mentioned, the DP would be defragmented into 5-year plans and later into annual plans. So the question was, what would be the first priority? Is it this way, everything would be started, like simultaneously the development would start in every sector, or is it like priorities to be given for some important points and then that way it can happen?
I thought you were suggesting me how to go about implementing the DP. That would have been wonderful, because your question is extremely important and that is the one with which we are currently struggling. My team is working that out. But I have certain priorities in my mind, and those priorities are, like everywhere else, you have to pluck the hanging fruits first, right? What are the hanging fruits in the DP? I have a municipal property. It's vacant. I have to build an amenity on it. Nothing prevents me today from bringing amenity into existence by building on that, because the land is already available. I think those would be the things that would be prioritized first, rather than start doing it in such a way that land would not be available. So the availability of land, availability of constructability of land already built, those would have priorities. But later we will have to go into details and we will have to see that the whole city, ward-wise, is balanced in terms of the public amenities that are available. And we will have to go into each ward and see what is the deficit in each ward. Is it educational? It is health? Is it public open spaces? Is it institutional areas? And then we will have to take a call on probably which are the wards that we need to prioritize, which are the sectors we need to prioritize. But that's an exercise that will take some time. But while it takes time, my suggestion to the corporation would be attack the properties that are already with you. Because then you would otherwise miss 2016-17 and go to 2000. Of course, we have to wait till the DP gets approved, right? Otherwise, they'll say they have already taken it for granted that it is approved. There'll be news items that DP taken for granted, already construction happening. But we'll have a ready plan for this year as well. Yes.
Hello, my name is Sonika and I'm from LTIS College. I have two questions. Firstly, regarding the population estimation that was done during the DP. It is estimated that in 2021, you'll be having the highest population, and 20 years down the line, the estimation, the population goes down. So how is that happening? Because we're making jobs for 8 million people. And next 20 years, accordingly, the migration will start affecting the entire city. So how is the estimation going down, the population estimation?
As I told you, we have taken this figure from the RP. But in the discussions I had with the regional plan authorities, and MMRDA's own studies are privy to this. See, over the last decade or so, development from Mumbai has been going out. People are working in Mumbai, but they are commuting from outside because living space is prohibitively costly here. So you have growth in Thane, Kalyan, neighboring areas like Panvel, Badlapur, all these areas, you know, are developing with housing and other facilities. Now, housing is something which can easily be done, but to get all the services that are required, that takes time. So what I visualize is that while people will live outside, if the quality of jobs in Mumbai are good, then people will commute with fast commuting available across this area and work here and go back. So the transportation network in the entire MMR has to be improved. This is something which has happened across the world. It's not peculiar to India. It has happened in the US, it has happened in the European countries, it has happened in South Asian countries, that over a period of time, land values in the larger cities become prohibitively costly and people start moving out. One of the reasons for that is also that, peculiar thing is happening in the 21st century. That is, that while a large city, a giga city for instance like Mumbai, has connectivities economically, socially, culturally with its own area, that is the MMR or say the state, it also gets catapulted where it has global forces working. So it becomes a global destination. Much of the cost, for instance, in Mumbai is housing not going down because there is a lot of speculative buying from outside. It's not always Mumbaikars who are going for these properties. So there are different forces playing in a city like Mumbai, which are both local, which are national, and which are international. At the local level and the regional level, this is the movement that is happening. People are living outside, working in Mumbai. We will not in any case like to lose the status of the prime commercial and economic capital of this country. So we must go ahead and see that quality jobs are created, more space is provided at lesser cost. So we have attacked on both sides. More availability means it will have an impact on cost, and the premiums etc. that were charged, they have been lowered, so that they will also have an impact on cost, and we feel that that would lead to a better situation in terms of employment.
There's another question. It is regarding the slum market, and we had a question earlier. So if NCGM has been so pivotal in working on the affordable housing and providing it to every needy section of society, then why the slum mapping is, why the government did not even allow it to simply map the slums and instead give it to the SRA?
I think government was driven by what is encapsulated in the constitution as well as in the acts. Under the constitution, if you read the 12th schedule, that gives the functions that a municipal corporation has. Housing does not figure there. So we are entering into housing because no one else is tackling it, and it's a basic problem here. And we have taken the state into confidence on this. But housing, you would see, that's why all the agencies are state agencies. MHADA, SRA. Housing is not a municipal subject.
So,
there was one proposed plan in which you said the public open spaces.
Just to add to that, but the question is right, because housing globally is a municipal subject. Just as policing is a municipal subject. These are two or three things in our country where housing, policing, these things are not within the powers of the municipal corporation.
Yes. So one of the plans that you mentioned was the open public spaces will not be concretized at all. But how does this conflict with the BMC's caretaker policy, in which one of the few other private people can actually go and develop one of the open spaces? How do these things do conflict?
If the DP gets approved as the way it has been proposed, there will be no conflict because the municipal corporation will be overruled by something which is approved by the government. The DP will prevail.
So,
you take care of the stakeholder participation. Can you shine some light on what do you mean by taking part of stakeholder participation in that process? And its implementation, because one of the major things of a DP preparation is looking at the economy of the region as a whole and what as a single entity. So when it comes to job creation, you mentioned that you're trying to create 8 million jobs and that much amount of buildable spaces, but it is something that is looking at only one sector of job creation. Maybe it's categorizing in ITs, in service sector, but it's not looking at the collective systems. It's not looking at maybe the entrepreneur systems that is existing in the city right now. And what we typically call them as TGA status, temporary ground allocations.
So why is the DP not really looking at these factors, which is essential for the overall overall fabric of the entire city?
But how do you say that the DP especially wants to provide space for activities that are of that nature? Those activities will not come in. We are not saying you can't do this at that space. So commercial spaces, you cannot specify that you should do this kind of a commercial activity or an official activity in that space. There are other activities that are possible, and there is no reason why DP should step in and say, no, you cannot do that. DP does not do that, because in a 20-year time frame, the kinds of changes that will happen, they cannot be foreseen today. What you are saying today after 10 years may not be valid. And we can see before our eyes that these kinds of changes are happening. So I don't think the DP precludes those kinds of activities. But your other question was, what was the first part?
The stakeholder participation.
Yeah, the stakeholder participation. It's a valid question. But remember, stakeholder participation that is happening currently is being done because of the realization within the system that there are people outside the system who are also knowledgeable and who need to participate. But there is no statutory provision for it. In fact, the statutory provisions providing for a mandatory kind of a stakeholder participation were mooted at some point in time, but they have not been formally enacted. That is a process that deepening of democracy has to take forward, where stakeholder participation becomes a mandatory part. But then in the system that we have, the stakeholder participation means that if there are groups of people who have views, then we invite them and take their suggestions. The formal way in which it happens is that the local representative, who is the councillor of that area, represents the people, and it is up to him to have the stakeholder consultations and give a feedback to the municipal body.
That's exactly where my question is. When you're talking about stakeholder participation, it is a group of people coming in either at this suggestion stage or before to the local authorities, the local BMC ward commissioner. But what is really important and what is not addressed in DP preparation is stakeholder participation at that particular stage. Like in a local area plan, it would really lead to a formation of a local area plan at the very beginning, rather than keeping it ambiguous.
How do you think that would happen? Under what statute that we will be compelled to have that kind of stakeholder participation?
You can't be compelled, but isn't it?
You should be compelled. If stakeholder participation has to happen, there has to be a statute for it. But and these were thought about. These were thought about, they are in the pipeline, but they have not happened. Otherwise, I mean, I remember my municipal corporation commissioner's days where I was extremely interested in having conversations with people who knew and who were prepared to give their advice. And I was asked every time by the general body members, who asked you to do this? Under what authority have you done it? And what is the answer that I give? So I think there has to be a movement towards that,
but,
and it should get formalized.
Okay, two more questions.
One quick question, because the others were waiting. Okay, you can't have
about the public open space allocation. When it comes to societies, when you said that if you can create a society with a maximum FSI of 2, you're also creating a public open space, which is for that society, and you're guarding it up. And that means that you're not opening up certain things back to the city. And I mean, Bangalore has adopted that policy. If you're developing a certain area, then you're actually giving a certain reservation or a designation back to the city. And what happens is if you completely develop to the brim, like if you take 2 FSI and add TDR, and after that, if there's in situ development in future, because you said that in future you cannot predict after 10, 15 years, if they want to redevelop it, after 20 years, if they want to redevelop it. And if the society members want to do an in situ, then they do not have any space. So how do you get to that?
No, as far as keeping public open space is concerned, it is mandated under the DCR that you have to keep a certain percentage which is open, whether you have FSI 10, 12, whatever. So you have to marry the height into your structure, but keep that 15% space open. Now, what I have said is that the entire city, all societies in the city, irrespective of any city, any society, want that their 15% open space should be inviolate and should be used only by society members. I think if the entire city is unified in a voice like this, and I think there is justice in that, because when you create a social space within a development, then it is for the enjoyment of that people. Others can enjoy other spaces, right? So that is why this was a demand that had to be conceded. One. Two, you are going to take all these spaces, designate them to make them public, then you must acquire them, right? Now, if you acquire them, you don't have the normal public community to the wherewithal to acquire that. Why do you want to take an extra loan? So otherwise, also, it is not practical. So if it is mandated under rules that that public open space will be there, and if it is enjoyed by the community, I think it is a good enough solution where thousands of societies enjoy their own common spaces and are happy with maintaining them. So I have neither the cost of maintenance, I have neither the cost of acquisition. I am maintaining those public open spaces that are universally open.
Yes.
So, you mentioned about planning at the ward level where you prioritize the amenities to be provided at a particular ward. But when we look at the behavior of people, like the preference of the people is not related to their locality. For example, schools or hospitals, their preference to using that amenities is completely different than being nearby. And that's, people have been traveling to acquire education for, they have traveled for us. So when you're planning at board level, are we considering or should we consider that? Because it might be that amenities provided by people may not use it because of no preference to that.
I think you have a valid question. What has happened is that many of the schools that are provided, they are not of the quality where people would like their children to go. But as far as DP is concerned, the DP has to provide those spaces. It is now up to the municipal corporation to impart that quality. You know, this is how it is in the rest of the world. In many countries, you have to go to the school that is nearest to your residence and no other school. That kind of a situation has not been brought here, because then you need to have schools that are standard everywhere and everyone is happy with all schools. I think we will come to a situation towards that. It's something which is actively being considered, and we are trying to work on a formula which could give us that kind of a result.
Hello, sir.
So we have one question there, and I think that three coming from this side. Or okay, last five questions, please. So we're really, really overshot in a big way.
So this is Kostorica. I'm from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. So my question is, there's a lot of migrant population that comes into the city of Mumbai, and they're one of the...
Thanks for coming from Tata Institute. Used to be my old institute where I used to lecture on tribals and forests. And I enjoyed my stays whenever I went to the Tata Institute. Please.
So my question was, there's so much of migrant population who are here for a seasonal basis or temporary basis. So when we talk about affordable housing, so how are we looking at these populations? Because I feel like the housing should be affordable to even them. Otherwise, they again move into the slums and we have this entire thing. So, like, if we have provision in the DP itself to look into this seasonal population that's coming in and dealing with, so don't you think it'll be a better way? And if you have, like, looked into it, I would like you to shed some light.
No, I think we have considered this kind of housing that is required. So if you read the affordable housing chapter, you would find that there is a mention that all of affordable housing need not be on a permanent basis. You have to have rental housing partly out of that. For instance, these multipurpose housing for women which are being created, there will not be a permission to stay there beyond a certain number of years, for instance 1 year, 2 years, because it's a place where it's not for long stay. It gives you an occasion to come there, stabilize yourself, and then find a place for yourself. But for that period, it will provide you a place. On the informal sector side, for instance, for the migrant populations, the homeless shelters that are being created, they could be utilized. We have provided for a large number of homeless shelters. So it is true that's a problem that needs to be addressed. But I think we have done justice to that problem.
Hi, my name is Manvi, and I'm also from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. My question was regarding the spatial provision for 8 million employment. You mentioned that includes both formal and informal. So I just wanted to understand, is there a ratio? What is the division between formal and informal? And how are you visualizing how this would take place? Because a lot of times informal activities are located towards your place of stay. So how do you think that would take place? Is there any...
I think your question is an excellent question. Unfortunately, as far as DP is concerned, the informal sector, we have tried to enter formal structures and given them certain spaces there. For instance, in markets that we will build, municipal markets, there would be vending zones within the municipal markets. This is the first time that it is going to happen. And those vending zones would be available for the informal sector for vending, out of which partly it would be for men and partly for women. The informal sector is very largely formed of these hawkers. Large number of hawkers are there. And for hawkers, we have provided by, not really through always through structures, but vending zones have to be determined by the vending committee of the municipal corporation. And since it's an act and it is statutorily provided, we will have to provide for vendors who are registered, and those could be on wherever possible, streets or other places or parking areas. And the flexibility has been brought in that other spaces that are not utilized for certain periods can be utilized for vending during those periods. So there is a multiple use of space that could come into commercial space, parking space, so on and so forth. But I think it's a much larger, the informal sector is a much larger question which has to be addressed also beyond the special provisions. And it is especially in regard to the instruments that are and the laws that exist which affect the informal sector. I think the ILO has listed, the International Labour Organization has listed a whole series of such things that impede the development of the informal sector. But the informal sector is a large subject. The definitional aspect itself is a debated subject. So I think we will have to have a separate session on informal sector if we were to debate that.
Okay, last question here, please. Go.
I have a small question related to DP authority and the judiciary system.
DP?
Judiciary system. So once the DP plan is approved and someone violates the DP plan and is caught, so is there a provision where the
DP is violated and
the violator is caught?
Is caught in
violating the DP.
Okay.
So is there a provision where the DP authority has a bigger hand over the judgment, or the passing of the judgment on a quicker basis, like the violator gets say stay orders coming from the court, and when the time comes, when the judgment is passed, the overall case is irrelevant when the time has come.
Your question gives supernatural powers to the DP. No, municipal corporation will have to take cognizance of violations of DP, and the violations have to be dealt with under the MRTP Act and the Municipal Act. But if he goes to the court, then the court processes have to be followed, and we will have to await a judgment from the court and then implement that judgment. That's how laws function in this country, and that is how it will continue.
I I think any more questions now, you can interact over the lunch when there's a when we go out for lunch and refreshments. You'll have plenty of opportunity, and there's a larger team of people who've been working on the development plan who'll also
I need to introduce them. Yes. We have our town planning officer, Mr. Hiren Daftardar. Yeah. He leads the town planning team. So the town planning officer is a principal officer who is responsible for the DP. So I can easily pass on my responsibility on to Hiren Daftardar, although I have not done that. But he's our main man. Kandalkar. He's the DCR master. So if you have any questions on DCRs and I can't answer them, you have to go to Kandalkar because he's the master. And another master is there, Bhatt. In fact, last night, who has also been an integral part of the DCR team. Last night I rang him up because I had forgotten what I had done with societies. And I thought some of you might ask me a question. So I told him, kindly clarify it once again because I'm getting old, I've forgotten. You had told me so. But, Sachdev?
Yeah.
Sachdev is our infrastructure man. So if you have any questions about roads, water, anything, he will run you through all that. He can name which road goes where and which water line goes where. So he has the ability to see underground. Mr. Kubar has been my man Friday. So management tasks, etc., have been framed by him. And he has told me this is going to be the chart, this duty has to be done first, this has to be done second. And every time I told him it's not to be done this way, he had a valid argument to say that this it should be done this way. So he was an indispensable member of my team. And Prachi, Mrs. Prachi Merchant. In this entire team, Hiren and Prachi are the only planners. They are planners and architects. And Prachi was my main face in terms of interacting with a whole lot of stakeholders. So if you ask her, which were the groups which interacted with her, with us on gender, which were the groups which interacted on homeless shelters, which were the groups that interacted on differently abled, I think she has a whole list. And I don't think I could have gone through all this without her. So these are key members that have come in and they have performed a miraculous job of finishing a DP in 1 year. That was the issue. In my first interaction with some of my friends, I said, someone rang me up and said, you have to come and do the DP. So I said, I'll come next fortnight and meet you. So, and I told him, what's the hurry? He told him, no, I need you immediately. So I said, what's the hurry? DPs are done at great leisure. They are done over 5-6 years. They are approved over another 5-6 years. So what's the hurry? He said, no, the government wants it done in 1 year. So then I doubled up and immediately came and took charge over. So this team has helped me get it through in 1 year. And I can tell you, towards the end, the government representatives were asking me, "Anki vel pahije ka? Eka varsha kasa honar hai?" So they were actually asking us whether you want more time. So we told them, no. 10 times we told you earlier that this is the time frame we want. Now that you haven't given to us, we will do it in 1 year and give it to you.
So our ward planners.
Where are they? Oh.
You all just please stand up for a round of applause. Please stand up.
What is where, because they were traversing their wards on foot. They had been asked, you have to visit the sites. And they have done this religiously. They know their wards in and out. Anytime anything was going amiss, they came to me and told me this is what is happening. They would come and tell this team that this is what is happening in a cooperative spirit, but also to keep a tab on what was happening. So they were actually our eyes and ears. And the DP part, where there are local area plans that have been prepared per ward, they have been prepared by them. I cannot take credit for doing that part. The rest of the chapters have been written by me. The area plans have been prepared by them. They were a tremendous source of inspiration, and they brought a breath of fresh air because they were fresh from their schools and colleges, and probably it was not too good for them working with this old team, but we were happy that we had a young team which was moving around and giving us the right advice and the kind of advice and the planning insights that we needed.
Thank you. Big round of applause, please.